Welcome to the National Tennis Centre. Thank you for giving up your Friday evening to come and further develop your coaching, and welcome to the Japanese group up the back. It's a pleasure to have you here, so thank you very much. For those of you that I haven't met before or don't know me or expected an Australian when you were being emailed by a gentleman called Neil Gregg from Cricket Victoria, that's me. I'm the Education and Training Coordinator at CV, and we, along with myself, along with my colleagues, the ACA and Cricket Australia, have put this evening together for you. As I said in the email, we're very lucky to have such a great array of presenters available to us through a variety of resources, and we thank them for giving up their time. I'll just quickly introduce them all, and once I have, we'll just give them a round of applause, and then we'll get into it. If anyone does need the toilet, it's over there, and the food and water won't leave the balcony until the end if anyone gets peckish or really thirsty. And just bang on time, just our caterers are just delivering some more, so there'll be plenty for everyone if they're hungry. Alright, so I'll just introduce our panel. So first, to my left, we've got Michael Bevan. So Michael was regularly dubbed the world's best limited over batsman during his career. He was an essential part of the Australian One Day team for over a decade, and was famous for orchestrating calm chases in crises, and also at the end of innings for Australia when they were setting. He'll long be remembered for innings against the West Indies in Sydney in 96 and just over the road against New Zealand in 2002, where nerveless batting and working with the tail secured nail-biting victories. Some of the key things that Michael's cricket probably taught kids like me of that generation and coaches coming through were his ability to pick the gaps, run hard, and knowing the right moment, when to go, when to stop, and his ability to risk, reward, analyse in his head. He was a fine fieldsman on top of that, and obviously picked up some handy wickets with his left arm spin bowling. So thank you for making the trip from Sydney, Michael, and look forward to hearing from you this evening. Next to Michael is Damien Fleming, so everyone will recognise Flem from the BBL commentary, and obviously his playing career, where he played 88 One Days for Australia, picking up 134 wickets. I think my lasting memory of Flem playing was in the 1999 World Cup against South Africa, where he probably displayed more calmness under pressure than Mike managed in all of his innings. While everyone around him was losing his head, he had the presence of mind to run Alan Donald out with an underarm to Gilly. Since his retirement, apart from his television work, Flem's obviously taken on a coaching role through his creation of Bowlology, which I'm sure he'll share with us tonight, as well as a couple of book plugs, I'm sure, Flem. Yeah. So, Damien Fleming, ladies and gentlemen. Next to Flem is Aminul Islam, or Bulbul as he's known to some of the people in the room. Aminul was one of Bangladesh's most celebrated cricketers in the pre-test status era. In their inaugural test against India, Aminul scored 145 runs, which is the second highest in the nation's debut test match. He batted for 8 hours and 55 minutes against what was a very strong team in world cricket at that point, to be the last man out. Aminul now plays a key role with the Asian Cricket Council, and he was a captain of Bangladesh at the World Cup, so his tactical nous and his experience of cricket across the Asian region will allow him to give us a real insight into a number of teams that are going to be participating at the World Cup. So, welcome, Aminul. And next to Aminul, our final member of the panel is Tilan Samaraweera. Most of you probably know Tilan best from his Test Match 100 over at the MCG. But he also played in 53 ODIs for Sri Lanka, scoring 200s with a batting average of 27.8 to go with his test average of 48.76, which is respectable across all teams in world cricket. In a batting lineup, probably more famous for their Jayasuriyas and Sangakkaras, Tilan's patience and solidity offered a vital balancing factor to the Sri Lankan lineup. Sri Lanka will long be remembered by most of us in this room for changing the landscape of one-day international cricket with their tactics and their colourful approach to an aggressive approach to the World Cup when they were introduced. As a highly qualified coach now, we'll look forward this evening to hearing Tilan's take on his country's chances and the upcoming tournament. So, welcome, Tilan. So as I indicated in the email, what we'll do this evening is I've got a number of questions that some of you provided to me via email, and we'll use that to get started, and then when the time that we have left in the evening, we'll take some questions from the crowd. Okay. So we'll start off with an absolute powder puff one. Bev, you want to go first? So the question is, what was your favourite World Cup moment?
Good question. I was fortunate to play in three World Cups, three World Cup finals, winning two. So I had a lot of good memories and a lot of different memories. The last World Cup I played in, 2003, we pretty much dominated the whole tournament. We had so many great players, and as a team we evolved to a different space and a higher level than a lot of other countries. And so my memory at that point in time from that World Cup was just how clinical we were in terms of and how successful we were. Whereas somewhere like the 99 World Cup was completely different. At that point in time, we had a slow start to the 99 World Cup, lost a couple of matches, had a different form. And to win the World Cup, we had to win seven matches, something like that, seven matches. And I think at that time, the team that I played for, we'd only ever won three in a row. So we had to sort of transcend what we'd done. And so for me, that was probably my best experience, was the 99 World Cup in terms of achieving something that no one thought we could achieve and being part of something immensely special. We've obviously just been talking previously about when you win a World Cup, it's special. It's hard to supersede that, but we also played in one of the best one-day games that I've always played in. So from a team perspective, the semi-final at Edgbaston was an amazing match that both teams had numerous opportunities to win. And it was just such a close game. So from a team perspective, that was a real highlight for me. From a personal level, obviously, probably the innings that stood out for me, or the innings that I was known for in my one-day career, was the innings that happened in 96 on New Year's Day against the West Indies, hitting the last ball for four. So for me, that was kind of my arrival as a one-day cricketer, as an international, and so I get remembered for that a lot, and it holds a really strong memory for me as being a part of, a major part of my one-day career.
Maybe a couple of points on that, Michael, just 3 points. It was only Roger Harper, let's be honest. Most of us could have hit him for four. And for the Sri Lankans in the room, we're not talking about the 1996 final. Me and Michael tried to get that out. And you'll never thank me for winning that semi-final against South Africa, so if you could just say a nice thank you tonight, I'd appreciate it.
Yeah, well, what were your fingers, actually? All right, thank you. You don't get picked for underarms, mate.
Liam, your favourite moment?
Obviously, just being able to win the World Cup final. Particularly, I think there was eight of us in that 99 World Cup team that lost the final to Sri Lanka. So to get that, because 3 or 4 years difference, you don't know whether you're going to play in another World Cup. So for eight of us to get the opportunity, And then you talk about cool clinical performance, Bevo, in 2003. Well, the final was like that, wasn't it? So Pakistan batted first, and sort of you were training going out of that semi-final against South Africa, but the standard of training was just high quality. We were up, and I just thought we were ready to peak, which we did on the day. And then having the opportunity to celebrate with all the Australian fans who were at Lord's. And then when everyone had gone, we took the trophy down to the pitch. Ricky Ponting had taken over the song from David Byrne. And we got to sing underneath the Southern Cross stand, you know, for hours and all that. And yeah, I reckon I learned a lot through that that campaign where Bevo said we were in trouble, we had to win every game, rely on results, and just learning that it doesn't always go to plan, but you know, you've got to be prepared to change things up, you know, commit as a team, and make sure you're there together to build that momentum. So yeah, with that pretty easy answer really, the 99 World Cup was just fantastic.
Aminul?
From a personal point of view, I must remember that 1999 World Cup, the day I went to toss with Fleming from New Zealand. That was the moment, actually, when I was a young fella, I never thought that Bangladesh would play one day match of Test match. So I was very lucky that during our era we played World Cup, and when I went to toss at a St. James cricket ground, that was my memorable moment. At the same time, when we beat Pakistan in 1999 World Cup, that was the last match for Bangladesh and Pakistan's group match. That was the most important moment for me and the country, because that was the first time Bangladesh beat a test match, test team. So that was the start, and I always remember that moment.
I think I played only one World Cup, that is 2011. Definitely good play against New Zealand in the final. In Bourne, it was a packed crowd, and New Zealand scored 220. They had it first, and they were 150 for one. Thinking about the final, and suddenly 160 for four. And myself and Angelo get through that tough period, and we put a 60 runs partnership, and I scored the winning run. I think that's the most memorable time in my life.
Thanks, gents. Aminul, got a question for you. So obviously, you talked about going out for the toss with Stephen Fleming. Being the first time that Bangladesh had featured on that stage, and like you said, you were a young man at that time, the expectations that you felt, and that you think that some of the emerging nations might feel this tournament coming around, how did you deal with them, and what were they, I guess?
Actually, for us, Bangladesh is a country that first time any type of World Cup, there was a sports cricket play, and 160 million people, everybody was following cricket and still following. And I remember that when we qualified for the World Cup in 1997, when we won the ICC trophy, we had a grand reception with a few million people came, and they expected that Bangladesh is going to win the World Cup. But they never thought that winning World Cup is a very tough thing. But the expectation was that. But we tried to give an idea that how tough is the World Cup, and all the best teams playing in the World Cup. So what we told before we left the country, that we will win two matches. One was very sure, which was Scotland. Scotland, but still, there was a good match. And also, one of the best teams, team, if we beat, then Bangladesh can prove the world that one country is coming with a lot of potential. And still, that's the only one time Bangladesh beat Pakistan. Hopefully, Bangladesh will beat Pakistan soon in the other years.
Thanks, Aminul. Flem, I guess we'll go to you. We'll just keep passing it along. So one of the questions from the coaches that are attending was, we've seen some slower balls, wide yorkers, slower ball bouncers, etc., come to the fore in recent times as the bowlology master. Is there anything you're expecting to see this World Cup?
Nothing, but I've really enjoyed the growth in the armoury of the fast bowls and the spinners as well there. And we're seeing with batsmen, their ability to hit 360 degrees now, that the ropes are in further, the bats are bigger, they're innovating more. But I just like how particularly the slower ball bouncer, I can't imagine actually bowling that. You'd think the batsman would have enough time to pick it and hit it through there, but talking to it through a few batsmen, you know, once you're down on the backswing, you can't adjust your bat speed. So that's been a clever innovation. The back of the hand, slower ball, although Steve Waugh and Simon O'Donnell used to bowl a similar delivery to that. That's been effective at times, but we saw, you know, the Melbourne Stars with Clint McKay and James Faulkner, who bowled that delivery really well in the first couple of years, but we found, not so much this BBL, the one before, batsmen were setting themselves back to those type of bowlers and just playing them as if they're going to bowl that every ball, and if it's the quicker one, they adjust to that. So the bowlers had to adjust a bit more. Like James started to develop a front of the hand off cutter. So, and the things I like about the innovations that are happening at T20 cricket, we've actually seen that morph into one day cricket and even test match cricket. So I think we're seeing more skilled cricketers playing, but it's still the art of actually deciding what ball to bowl at that time, you know, with the pitch conditions, with what the batsmen are doing, and vice versa, I think, when you're batting. And one of the first real innovators was Steve Waugh, and he really helped us win that World Cup in 1999. He was under pressure to keep his spot. His strike rate wasn't great in one-day cricket. I think after we'd lost 2 out of 3, Trevor Holmes, our chairman selectors, basically said, mate, if we don't win this World Cup, you're basically out of the one-day team. But so he knew he had to increase his strike rate. He had to increase his scoring zone. So he developed that slog sweep, which I think everyone can remember. And Jeff Marsh, our coach, you know, threw thousands of balls through. And I think a year earlier, 98 final in India, you know, he hit 18 off the third last over to get us home. And in that World Cup, you know, probably the best one-day innings I saw was that 120 against South Africa, when he did say, or he didn't say, to Herschel Gibbs when he dropped that ball, you know, bad luck, champ, you cost yourself the World Cup. I reckon he said it better. But he ended up, that slog sweep got him through. And the shot for me was Steve Alworthy, who was quite a big bowler, you know, high 130s. And he actually slog swept him for 6. So it showed to me, one, that it doesn't matter what age, like Steve Waugh was a legend at that stage. And if he'd finished, no one, his legacy wouldn't have been, you know, disappointing at all. But he wanted to be number one, he wanted to get better. He developed his shot, and it kept him in one-day cricket for 2 or 3 more years. But he actually started to get using him for test match cricket. So we like the constant improvement from the players, and I think each era that goes through, you want to see that wow factor, that they do things to the extreme. So looking forward to seeing a lot of innovation in this World Cup.
Yep. Tilan, I might throw it to you, just because we're mates and you won't be bothered about an unprepared question. But Lasith Malinga, Murali, obviously innovators in terms of bowling. And Jayasuriya took batting to a different level as well when he went bananas at the top of the order. So, how did Sri Lanka come up with 3 such innovative cricketers, I guess?
I think we played a lot of soft ball cricket. I think that's why we have different actions, we have different flair in batting. I think coaches never, junior cricket especially, coaches never touched that flair. I think that's the most important thing. They never go over technique. They never stop the flair thing. That's why we come, a lot of different cricketers come from our country.
And are you anyone that you're expecting from Sri Lanka this year to do anything that's going to amaze us?
In big 3, definitely. Should score runs, Dilshan, Sangakkara, and Jayawardene. If they score runs, I think we will do this in big stages, definitely.
Thanks, Tilan. Mike, I guess a lot of the questions that the coaches are keen to hear from you is around some of the stuff that you touched on as your favourite moments. So, I guess there's 2 parts to it, and we'll kind of break it up so it doesn't become too long-winded for you. When you were in a run chasing going out to bat, how did you plan it in your head? Were you walking out and you need 100 off 10 overs? What was your mindset and your plan, I guess?
Look, my overriding mindset and what I felt my role was to be there at the end. And so to do that, to be there at the end, what are the things that had to happen for me? So I would sort of analyse the bowlers, analyse the wicket conditions, take into account my strengths and weaknesses, take on board the match situation, and then put it all into the mix and come up with a strategy or a plan in terms of what I felt was the best opportunity for me to get to the end of the match. I think as a, I was fortunate, like one of the keys when you're chasing runs is to take the pressure off yourself. So you have to have key focuses that enable you to do that. And I never really worried if we were going to lose a match. I knew that sometimes we would win and sometimes we would lose. So I was always comfortable with losing a match. And I always reduced it back to, well, what do I want to achieve out of this? You know, do I want to get 60 runs off 60 balls? And if that became a goal, your smart goal or whatever, I mean, my focus wasn't on winning the match. It was actually just scoring a run of ball. And so what I tried to do is really take the focus off the outcome, I suppose, where possible, and just have little tangible things that I could focus on, concentrate on, have the right plan. And I know we've talked about a little bit about innovation and all those types of things. And so one of the things that I developed, or one of the strategies that I developed, is after putting all those things in the mix, I would come up with one four ball and one single. And they were my only two options, because I've just calculated that's my best chances and choices to eliminate risk and to bat for a long time. Now, I was a little bit different to a lot of batters in one-day cricket and a lot of batters in the longer version, in the sense that I was a little bit structured, analytical. And batting's two things. Batting is about decision-making, and it's also about letting go and trusting your instincts. So there's two parts to batting, or there's probably more parts to batting. And I was very strong in terms of being very, very clinical in developing the right game plans. But of course, sometimes that affected me when sometimes I should have let go. It affected my scoring rate. So I sacrificed scoring rate to be there at the end, I suppose. But then I had little different strategies of when I needed to up the run rate and all those types of things. So it never really changed for me. I always felt comfortable in that role, and I felt a really strong responsibility to be there for the team. And that was nothing to do with the cricket. That was to do with me as a person in terms of an obligation that I felt. So you could say that it was the right role for me in terms of matching your skill set and your personality with what you're trying to achieve as a team, I guess. So yeah, that's kind of a brief overview. Wasn't too long-winded, was it?
That's perfect, yeah. Flem, I guess I'd just like to, I guess you're in a unique position of having played with Michael and now being involved with arguably the two guys that as a commentator, your colleagues might be putting some pressure on to fill Michael's role for Australia, and Maxi and James Faulkner. Different characters, definitely, but do you see a lot of similarities in terms of how they approach it?
Probably a little bit of Faulkner in Bevo, but the great thing about Bevo is the legacy. When someone bats with that accumulation and hitting gaps and then finding the boundaries and getting the total late, yeah, it's Bevan-like. And the first copycat that we had was Michael Hussey. So Michael Hussey, when he first played for Western Australia, used to open the batting with Ryan Campbell, and you kept Hussey. Like, he struggled to, particularly driving, he couldn't hit through the gap. So you're happy to keep him in and you try and get Ryan Campbell out. He got dropped because his strike rate was really low in one-day cricket. And I remember playing against him for Victoria. He only came in because I think Kadich was injured. And he came in and batted six and got 100. And it was very much like the way that Bevo used to bat. He just hit the gaps ran really well, and that's where Bevo was so quick between the wickets as well. And he started to build a game plan based on Bevo, and then you see the cricketer that he ended up. It's amazing to think that early on in his career we used to keep him in there. So other guys would obviously mimic Bevo and Huss. But you hope guys mimic, but then they actually respect their own flair. And for someone like Walker, he's a great fella, really popular around the group. He's very cricket smart, particularly with his batting. He very rarely in the first 6 to 10 balls, even in T20 cricket, he never slops. He's happy to be 10 off 10 balls, knowing that he's got the power to, which he did at the Wacker in his last game. I think he was 8 off 10 and then got 50 off 24 balls, I think. You know, he finished without 4 sixes in a row. So it's nice being able to do that because you've got the power. You know you can do that. But I like how he constructs an innings. Maxi hasn't quite learned that yet. He hasn't really learned the art of batting in all forms. The last couple of innings have been promising. The 90 he got in Perth, he gave himself a chance, and then he finished with acceleration. In that game against India, he did the same there. So Maxi's a little bit below Faulkner at this stage, but I'll see Maxwell as a guy who can get in a bit earlier and make big hundreds. He reminds me more like Andrew Simons. So Simo, when we first started playing with him, he was brilliant, but he was unpredictable. He'd let you down in key situations. We had no idea about his game. And then when he found some consistency, picked in the 2003 World Cup, and on stats, he shouldn't have been there, but John Buchanan with Ponting, big fans of Simo, they got him in there, 150 in the first game against Pakistan, and there he went. And then I asked him a couple of years later, once he started to play Test cricket, I was interviewing him, and I saw an interview where he said he found the map to his batting. And I asked him to actually clarify what that map was. And I can't remember word for word what he said, but there was things he had to do before that ball to get himself right, to be able to perform at his peak each delivery. So even for someone, Bevo's very analytical, Simo's at the other end. He's a total mozzie. He buzzes around everywhere. But even a guy who's totally unstructured in a lot of things, he needed some structure to get consistencies, and he found the map to his career. So I think Maxi is still in that Simo zone, and hopefully this is Maxi's alternative to Simo's 2003 World Cup. This is the one where he finds the map to his game. He bowls a bit like Simo as well. He's dominant in the field. He could be the most dominant player in this World Cup.
Tilan, we'll run off the Glenn Maxwell a little bit. So obviously he's well considered to pull out the unorthodox shot at any given moment. You are a more orthodox player, as you said. How do you see players, obviously Maxi's at one end of the scale, you were at the other end, how do you see players in the modern era that are able to flick between the two of them?
I think modern game changed a lot, and players have different challenges different requirements need to successfully in the 20 and 50 over cricket. As a batsman, modern players have different, they face different challenges, especially different field settings, different variations, so many variations come into play now, slow bowls, wide yorkers, and most probably now they chase almost, when you play 50 over cricket, they almost chase 300 runs. And T20 cricket, which is 170, 180. And that's why so good modern players, more horizontal back shots come into play, and they do more ramp shots, more reverse sweeps, because they try to hit 360 degrees.
So as a coach in the modern era, which you are, obviously working with our academy kids and everything like that, how do you approach coaching them to do something like that?
I think, definitely for the younger kids, 11-year-old, below 15-year-old kids, I think most number one thing in personal opinion, number one thing is setup. When your setup is right, you can go with technical shots. I think those two is the key for the below under 15 in Sri Lanka. They ban till 18, you can't play T20 cricket. Because too much younger kids too watching too much T20 cricket, and they lost their technique and they lost their setups and all.
Aminul, what similar questions around the changing of the game now, the innovation in shots and things from your time?
Actually, the format of the game is totally changed now. Like, it used to be multi-day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, then very popular 50 was to get now T20s. So selecting a player or selecting the right player for the right format is totally different depending on a lot of powers involved now, a lot of skill is involved there now. So sometimes you need a mixture of both. But what I've seen, normally for the international cricket is there. If we see this wristwatch, there are three machines working. One is a perfect seconds. Perfect seconds gives us perfect minute. Perfect minute gives us perfect hour. So if we have a correct technique, and if the technique they use in the nets and some random scenario perfectly, and if they use both in the critical situation, then you can find that some of the players are very, very consistent and successful in all three formats, like Dhoni and some of the other players. They are very good in T20s, very good in 50-50s, and also in multi-day cricket. So it's very much important, the temperament and technique. So nowadays, because of T20, it's a little different than previous World Cups, previous ODIs. The target, it used to be 260, was very safe score. But nowadays, 300, sometimes, if something in some subcontinent, 350 is not safe. So it's more batters game now. The laws, the rules, whatever they're making for the batters. Now, in this World Cup, we'll see five fielders inside. So everything is for the batters, so the batters are getting more advantage in the world. What do you think?
Oh, perfect.
It's about time. Yeah, I mean, it's been a bowler-dominated game, cricket hasn't recently, so it's good to see some rules finally going towards the batsman.
I guess one of the questions that someone asked, Clem, and it leads in nicely, is obviously with the two new balls now in 50-over cricket, is that, in your opinion, having an adverse effect on swing bowling and reverse swing bowling specifically?
Yeah, I'm listening to hear what the other boys say there as well. Well, one of the features of 50-over cricket years ago was reverse swing. And when we remember the final here at 92, I don't know if you guys have been watching on Fox Sports, but it was in Akram's two deliveries. Yeah, we were amazing. You know, the way the one that went away from Alan Lamb from around the wicket, and he knocked over Chris Lewis' second ball. We won't see that here, as long as all the bowlers have been legit with their fingernails and all that sort of stuff. Besides maybe Adelaide Oval, SCG, that actually wear the ball down so reverse swing is possible. You know, I think it's an art of the game that I think is missed. And I'm not sure if you missed batting against it, but with the two new balls, they've probably done that to give the bowlers more of a chance with new ball bowling, but it hurts you at the end when you're bowling at the death because the 25-year-old ball is still nice and new. Some of the fielding restrictions I don't like. Four out in the last 10 overs, it's too hard. You know, you've got to have five out. You've got to be able to protect at least one, three on one side and two on the other. Batsman takes a chance where that is. I reckon that's really, really tough there. But yeah, it's definitely a World Cup where the new ball bowlers, you've got to get it right. You've got to have guys who swing the ball, pitch it up, make sure you use the slips if there's any swing. I don't think there'll be a lot of seam in this World Cup. Maybe a bit over there in New Zealand. That's where I think New Zealand are a real threat because Bolt, Southie, those type of bowlers are going to get some bowler-friendly conditions. And they're really high-end, talented bowlers. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how teams deal with that because someone like India, who I would think coming into the tournament were a good chance to score big. I don't think they got the bowlers to defend 250, but they could defend 300. But we saw in the tri-series, the two new balls against their batting lineup, they haven't been able to mount an attack. They're losing wickets in the first 10 and they're sort of nowhere. So, yeah, I wouldn't mind. It'd be interesting to see. I'm not sure if you guys have got thoughts on whether we need the two new balls in one day cricket as opposed to just the one and seeing a bit of reverse swing.
It depends on the wicket actually. When we play in England and South Africa and Australia, the pitches are more grass. But when you play in subcontinent, there's not much grass in the pitch. So it's 100% clay pitch. So in those conditions, probably they need two balls.
I think I don't agree with my fielders inside the circle, because it's very hard to bowl last 10, because when you set a field, that's going to know this is the area, we'll bowl a ball. I think that's more predictable now. That's why 30, 40 runs extra every game, you have to chase down what you did in before that, 3 years before, because rules change and other thing is two new balls. Biggest thing is hard to bowl part-time bowlers with five fielders inside, and especially with the spinners, supporting teams, we struggle to bowl their part-time spinners because five fielders inside, not easy to bowl. And other thing is now modern captains have to have more technical awareness. That's key for this World Cup.
Mike, just a couple of, we'll lead on from Tilan's before we go into another question. As a, I would say better than part-time bowler, but as a probably the sixth or seventh bowler in the Australian team, do you agree with what Tilan's saying? How would you have approached bowling with a newer ball?
Yeah, what's your test average for that with the ball? 25? It's not bad. 24. Okay, so sorry, what do you want me to talk about?
Just your.
Because I don't watch one day cricket. I didn't even realise that you had two new balls and only kept four in the ring at the end. So.
Bowling in a one day game now with a newer ball and the fielding restrictions. How would it have changed?
For me?
Yeah.
Oh, look, seriously, there was a period there where I played test cricket as a bowler and had a couple of good series, and seriously, every time I was at the top of my mark, I was shitting myself. I had no idea where the ball was going. And I remember they picked me as a head of pistol in the PE. We played on a green seamer in Port Elizabeth, and I'd taken up all these wickets in the previous matches, all tail-end wickets, and they were trying to keep Mark Taylor in the team throughout the period where he wasn't scoring any runs. So it stuffed up the balance. So we took two seamers into a green-seaming wicket against South Africa, and I was shooting myself. The only thing was that McMillan couldn't pick the wrong... Like, no-one could pick the wrong one. So I was brilliant against anyone who couldn't pick the wrong one. West Indies... but I struggled against any quality batters in terms of playing if they played spinners. In terms of the new balls or the field positions, you know, look again. Can you match the field positions with the batter's strengths and weaknesses, and then can you execute into those areas that you need to do? And I'm a bit of a stats guy, and so. You know, one of the things that I did when I was sort of coaching over in the IPL for one season, is that I asked my stats guys to come back to me with every single ball that was bowled in every area and apportion a run rate to it. So every ball that is bowled in that area goes for 0.5 of a run in this period. Every ball that is bowled in another period to a different bowler goes for this amount of runs. So I just look and say, right, this is the best ball, these are the right fields, this is our best chance to create pressure on the batters, which is what you're always trying to do. So that's the way I would be looking at it, which comes back to, you know, being able to having the best game plan possible in the circumstance and situation, and then being able to deliver. And it's, we've talked about it a couple of times here tonight, is that. And the bowlers have got a larger repertoire, the batters have got a larger repertoire, and in a sense that provides real challenges as coaches and team managers, because they've got more options, not less. And sometimes those options are only 80% instead of, you know, they might have 10 options at 70% rather than 5 options at 100%. And so, I'm a big one for just sort of getting as much information on the opposition batsman as possible. I don't know if that's probably that, you know, it still doesn't really answer the question how I would bowl, because, you know, He just anywhere near the good length was fine for me. Anywhere near a good length. Although the full toss was a good wicket, good ball for me in Test cricket. I got quite a few wickets with a full toss. Bit of dip. But mate, bowling I had no idea. It was just, you know, getting them up there and hoping that I was somewhere near the mark.
I guess when you touched on the IPL and what you said earlier about knowing your boundary in a single and being there till the end, with the Big Bash coming in and the guys that are going to be playing in the World Cup having played a lot more international 2020 cricket than you would have played, do you reckon that figure would have changed and that your required runs that you wanted to get an over would go up? Because we've seen Pete Hanscom against Perth, one from a situation where, apart from probably Fleming in the commentary box, no one was backing them in. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think definitely. I mean, when I first, one of the reasons, and we've talked about it, is, well, the two reasons, two factors or two things that you really need to work in your favour as a batter and probably a bowler is, and it's a consideration for all coaches and a point to work to in the future is, how many skills do you have and what's the quality of those skills? And so when I first came in to play one day cricket for Australia, my competitors were David Byrne, Mark Taylor, even Steve Waugh to a certain degree, in terms of being able to compare strike rates. So my strike rate, I had more options than those guys at that point in time, and a higher strike rate, so I created less pressure. And so no doubt they felt under pressure for me at that point in time, but fast forward 10 or 15 years, I was starting to feel pressure again, like from guys like Michael Clark, Andrew Simons, because they had more skills than what I had. Maybe higher quality skills or whatever you want to call it. So the strike rate has definitely come up, without a doubt. And in a sense, we've got more skills. And in a sense, one of the challenges the coaches are faced with and players is, when do we use those skills in terms of game plans? And as Fleming mentioned with Maxwell, he hasn't found his game yet. And I believe, you know, I think when you talk about someone like a Jeff Marsh or a Justin Langer and how many tests they played, I mean, seriously, one had a cut shot and the other had a flick off their legs. The other one had a flick off the legs and a pull shot. And they each played 100 tests. And so I'm a big believer in I believe the differential between players is one word, and that's consistency, which is what it is we're all trying to achieve as a player and as coaches. Because if you look at, from where I am, first-class cricketers, every first-class cricketer is going to have either a good game, a good season, or maybe a good couple of seasons, or a good session. And they're all good players. Same with first-grade cricketers, is that every cricketer at some point in time is going to have a good period. Which answers the only question you need to ask. Are they good enough? Yes. So then it becomes about, how do we develop their consistency? And that's the difference between a great player and a good player, or a good player and an average player. Just the consistency.
Awesome. I'm almost like I'm writing the answers. Tilan, you had touched on on who you see the key players for Sri Lanka being in the World Cup and mentioning Jayawardena and Sangakkara, and obviously they've been legends of the Sri Lankan game. Their legacy to the group coming up, because as expected they'll step away from the team reasonably soon. What is it that they bring to the group, and how hard will it be for them to be replaced?
It's really hard to replace them, definitely, because those two achieved so much for the Sri Lanka cricket. Especially they, those two scored 50,000 runs close to it, and 100-100s close together, and without that 100-100s, 200 double hundreds, 70 double hundreds they scored. And I think definitely they are the more role models for the younger generation. We miss definitely, but in this World Cup, I think these two should score lots of runs for the progress to the bigger stages.
Do you see their, has their role changed over the years, or have they just been able to continue to develop naturally through their career and their roles have evolved through that?
I think they develop a lot in their careers, especially Sangakkara the last 4 to 5 years. He's a tremendous cricketer, what is Michael said, so much consistency coming to play his last five years with all three formats. And I think most important thing is they have more experience now. They know their games very well, and they execute it very well.
Excellent. We'll go with, we've got one last question before we'll open it up to the crowd. And I guess this is a question that someone's asked for all of you. So Shane Warne was famously said that a coach was there to take the team to and from the ground, but obviously everyone here thinks that coaches play a more important role, hopefully. I guess the question from the participant was what's the coach's role around tournament time? What's the environment that they're trying to create? How are they working through the 28 days that a tournament goes for? I guess so that's for everyone from their experiences.
Looking at this big event, all the coaches, they have their different plans. But three major plans, I think, which can encourage the team, encourage the overall system for this hype of this tournament. Number one is the discipline. There are two types of discipline, what I think that coach will follow with. One is the normal discipline, with what dress they're wearing, what time they come for training, what time they come for the team meeting. And one more discipline, which is very, very important, that is that managing their skills. Suppose a batter, he knows his skills of stopping the ball, leaving the ball, and hitting the ball. So it's very important to manage the skills when, what time, what skill to use. That's one of the most important thing. If the coach follow this and maintain this, I'm sure that coaches, most of the team will be successful from this tournament. Second thing is that the spirit of this game, because it's very, very important for modern cricket, which is respecting the opponents, respecting the umpire's decision, obviously, following the match rules, playing conditions. And the third thing is the integrity. Now it is a lot of controversial things goes through during the tournament, during the matches. So integrity is one of the most important things. So if these three things, which is the discipline, team spirit, the spirit of this game, and obviously the integrity, if three things join together and any coach goes through and follows this, I'm sure that most of the teams will be successful in this tournament.
It's just on crossword.
Back from the coaches, totally back up the discipline thing. You know, they're the ones that direct that along with the captain. You know, just simple things, as you said, you got to be on time, you got to wear the right thing, you know, respect all your teammates there. Also, you know, running training and all that. As a player, from the captain coach, I just want to know, what's my role and expectations for this World Cup? You know, when do you want me to bowl? You know, what type of bowling? And I can practice that and fill a role within the team. So other than that, you know, I think I like the players to take a lot of self-responsibility and know their game themselves and take a lot of responsibility for that. But certainly the coach and captain can help create a winning culture, a winning environment for everyone to buy into. And within that, if you feel like you're filling a role and you're respected around the group, I reckon great things can happen.
Thanks, Damien. I don't know. I don't know what other coaches are doing. I know what I'd be trying to do going into a 6-week tournament. The first thing is what you want players to be is to be really clear. So there's no question marks about, one, what's the expected performance in terms of targets and the roles that they're required to play in the game. And you've dumb that down, make them smaller so they're achievable and they're very clear about what are the performance expectations from them. The second part that they need to be really clear about is how they're going to do that. How are they going to hit their targets? What their plans are going to be. So you're creating that sort of map that Flemo's talked about for them, so they're really clear. Secondly, the second thing you'd be trying to reinforce is to build a level of confidence, I think, throughout the tournament. I mean, they've got their performance targets, they've got their game plans. What they need is confidence then to allow, to let it happen. So you'd be trying to build in a level of confidence within those game plans throughout the tournament. How you do that? Not sure at this stage. Maybe you can ask me that a bit later and I'll think of a few things to say. But thirdly, and this is my approach, and everyone's got a little bit different approach and they have different concepts they work off, but my five keys for building a culture, and that's what you want. You know, you've got the individual performance and then you've got the culture. So throughout the tournament, I would be trying to build trust between the players. That's the first thing. I'd be trying to then build communication. Then there's the commitment that we've talked about. So you actually need to build the commitment. You want players committed to it. So it's great to have targets and it's great to have plans, but unless you have commitment to it, then it's absolutely irrelevant. So that'd be really high on my list, building commitment throughout the group. Then I would go to accountability. So I want all the players accountable. So I'd build accountability in there. And then the last thing I do is that, like, I think in big matches and big tournaments, and you know, your emotions are high and people tend to bullshit each other and say, yes, we nearly got there and, you know, it's going to turn. If you don't get there, address the issue and understand why you didn't get there. And so have a team meeting or a conversation that you're understanding what were the issues, why didn't it work, what things do you need to put in place to hit your targets and all those things. So that's kind of a quick snapshot of the way I would approach it as a coach going into a tournament like this.
Sorry, just all right. And we had a bit of a situation in that World Cup 99, didn't we, after we'd lost 2 out of 3. We had a crisis meeting. The captain and coach had tried to enforce a couple of things in there, one being a total alcohol ban. But we went with McGrath bowling first change, didn't we? Myself and Dale opening up the swing bowlers. The middle order was a bit of rotation there. And so we'd lost 2 out of 3 and we had a meeting in Headingland. Good on Jeff Marsh and Steve Waugh as captain and coach. They said, we're not leaving this room until we're committed. And that's where Tom Moody really stood up and he used his term, we need to erase the zone of doubt. So a lot of things you're touching on there, if there's any doubt within the playing group, you're not going to go on to win the World Cup. And I remember you, Bevo, you know, who was a pretty intense character, as you could probably tell. You felt like we were putting too much pressure on ourselves. So it's funny for probably our most intense player to identify that. Our game plans weren't great. They were very general. So myself and Adam Dale actually worked on bowling plans, 0-10, 11-2. You'd think that would have been done before the tournament. And it was great from Adam Dale, he ended up getting dropped after that game, but he's still committed to doing the bowling plan. So ideally that would have been done at our training camp in Cardiff, but also when you go on a journey like that, it's not all going to go to plan, but you've got to identify, as Bevo said, you've got to deal with the issues, yeah, you've got to commit together, and then once we got out of that dressing room, so we started to win, and we started to win well, because I reckon we owned it. And when you put your hand up and say you're going to help with the bowling and batting plans, well, you've got accountability because you've said you've got to do it, you've got to back you up. So when you've got most of your group owning the process and they've got accountability to back it up, not just a captain and coach, then you start to build momentum and luckily we went through to win the tournament.
I think that's all about preparation. Is it 2011 World Cup? When we finished the first round, we had clear rules because we know we will get either New Zealand or South Africa in the quarterfinal, or either England get quarterfinal, semifinal, South Africa or New Zealand. And we all the batters know the rules because selectors and coaching staff sit down and say, okay, we'll play Kitarama, that's a spinning track, we'll play three spinners and Lasith Malinga. That means all four bowlers can't bat, honestly. And you have to finish the game within that seven batters. That's a clear rule, because if you play all-rounders, we will chase to 280, 270. If you play proper four bowlers, we end up to 20, 230. I think that's a better option to get batters. Those are very clear things. And after that, a lot of coaches try to organize more fun field activities like question and answer sessions, movie nights, dinner outings, more family get together. Those things help create the environment calm. That's the most important in this. When you go to the World Cup, your environment should be calm on and off the field.
Awesome. Thanks, Tilan. Thanks, guys. So what I'll do is now open it up, and you guys will, I'm sure, have plenty of questions. If you just, old school style, put your hand up and I'll point to you, and then if you can just speak as loudly as possible. Who would like to start us off? Yep.
Just for Damien, in under 12, you have about a month or
how? No, but I've just come through the under 12s and 14s at the moment.
Most of them are stopping at the wicket when they bowl. You know, they've got a 40 yard run up and then they stop at the wicket. My son was doing this last year as well. How do you coach them where they can jump through that wicket?
Yeah, and most of them stopping and jumping up, but not going. Everyone's asking, gentleman here is asking about bowlers, particularly young kids who are running up a long way, but then stopping and then bowling the ball, so losing. Because the main thing about, well, a lot of things about bowling, one of them is you want momentum going through the crease, whether you're a quick bowler or even a spinner, because even spinners have got, you know, someone like Warner, he had amazing momentum through the crease, didn't he? And obviously his wrist and fingers weren't behind the ball, so that's why he didn't bowl that quick. That's why how he got so much grip on the ball and variance and bounce. Well, straight away, you've got to shorten it. I mean, they can't be exhausted. Like Stuart Broad's going a little bit through that at the moment. If you watch what he's doing, he's at his fastest at the start of his run-up. Then he slows, then he quickens up a bit, then he slows again. So that's not momentum, is it? So I reckon just the old one of, you know, small steps to long steps. And you make sure that, yeah, get balanced on that. Your run-up only needs to be as long as that you're totally balanced as you take that takeoff step. And you're jumping towards the target, not up. So I'll be shortening the run-up straight away and making sure from that takeoff step. And even if it means only taking a run-up from a few steps and getting them to take two steps, jump, and then bowl the ball, I bet you they'll be able to, after a while, they'll be able to get the ball down with a reasonable pace off a couple and then work them back to 10 or 12 steps. But it happened a lot when I was young. Bevo was a quick bowler as a youngster too. Damasili, you know, even kids snap that. The run-ups are too long. Once you lose momentum in your run-up, you're never going to get it again. So short to long and jump towards the target and follow through, you know, out of the danger area, but you want to make sure you're just off the pitch. If their follow-throughs are too quickly off, you know that they've probably jumped in and they've jumped off, so they're not maximising their momentum, probably dropping on their back foot, losing bounce there as well. So I'm a big one on, you know a little bit of angle to your run-up. But generally, if you jump towards off stump, and the front arm's another one, I don't know, in under 12 kids, a lot of them don't use that, and girls as well, there, Mick. And once you're taking it out that way, and my momentum's going that way, it's going to be pretty hard to get it down with pace and bounce.
Awesome. Thanks, mate. Yep.
You mentioned about angle,
and
consistency. In your change from being player here to becoming here, you obviously became consistent. What did you do? What changes happened? Did you eliminate 10 shots? Did you get fitter? Did you have a lot more throwdowns? What changed you to become that elite player?
How did I achieve consistency and how did I improve my game? and how did I become? Well, see, I mean, I still felt that I underachieved. I mean, I always thought I was going to play 100 tests. And, you know, I didn't quite achieve my potential. So I didn't quite find my plan until the back end of my career. But I was a very talented player, and I was a very hard-working player. And at the age of 27, I was dropped from the Australian cricket team for the second time in Test cricket. And I had a bit of an issue with the short ball in 94 getting dropped, and then I went away, worked on it really hard, had hundreds and thousands of balls, the short balls where I practiced, only to come back in the Test team at the age of 27 for a second time and then get out to cricket short ball. So for me at that point in time, I knew I would never play Test cricket again. And up until that point in time, I hadn't really learnt any. I was just a hard-working player who was really talented, who'd never learnt any. And I suppose it's become the cornerstone of my coaching, and it's why I get interested in coaching, and it's the part of coaching that I'm interested in, is the part where there's that kind of light bulb moment, you know, with the coach or with the player, where you say, ah, that's what I've got to do, or that's my issue. And so one of the reasons, and one of the things that I believe helped me become consistent, is I understood what was holding me back. And I think as coaches, there's too much peripheral stuff going on. We go through the motions, we discuss technique, we talk about game plans, but we don't really understand the real issues or the issues that are holding us back as players. And so one of the things that I became really good at is I understood what my problem was. And for me, it wasn't my talent, it wasn't my work ethic, it wasn't my practice habits, it wasn't my game plans, it was my confidence and self-esteem. So, you know, and people talk about backing yourself or being confident or doing all these things, but we can't really articulate it. We don't really understand why it impacts us or how we can improve it. And so for me at that point in time, I simply understood that I worried about what people thought of me too much. I was putting too much pressure on myself. I wasn't as confident as I should have been. So you know what I did for the next 8 years of my career? I didn't work on my cricket. I worked on me. And every time I was faced with a situation that challenged the way I thought, I had something in place that I would just repeat to myself to make me feel comfortable, confident, and ready to deliver on my skills. And I don't know if I'm a good coach. I'm certainly not, I wouldn't think, a great communicator. Never really been a people person, Flynn, have I? But I do believe I have the ability to really understand, because I'm quite analytical, what is going on. What is the issue that is holding that person back, or me back, or whatever. And for me, that was where my consistency kicked in. My second season of Shield, I scored 5 centuries in a row in 5 games. Then the next season, I put so much pressure on myself, I didn't score a run. And so for the first part of my career, I was like that. And then for the back part of my career, I think my average went from 50 or 60 to 75 or something like that. So for me, that in first-class cricket, so for me, I understood what I needed to do at the things that were limiting me, I suppose, and what I had to do in the game. Yeah.
And sorry, did that help you with the short ball too?
At that time I was a shot clerk. I was just eating, breathing, sleeping short balls. And look, I was always a decent player with a short ball, but I got too caught up into it. I made it a big issue and it wasn't. Probably not. I was probably defensive, but I learned how to handle it and get through it. I mean, probably much like Steve Ward did learn to do in his Test cricket. I just didn't get the opportunity in Test cricket because I didn't play again. But first class cricket, I improved. So, yeah, I think I was a better player. I was a better player.
Aminul, just on that. So obviously, I touched on it in the introduction, but eight hours and 55 minutes on Bangladesh's first test against India. About 5 hours into the innings, how was your thought process going in terms of the step up from what you'd been playing beforehand into this test match, longer format against what was a superstar lineup?
Actually, I can't express and explain what happened, but I do remember that before the first test match, we went to South Africa for a trip, and we were bundled out two matches, 50, one match all out by 50 runs, and another one match 60 or 70. So overall, the confidence level was very, very low. What happened, I started reading books, and one of the books from Mark was said that play one ball one time, at one time. So following that, and I was trying to read books from Sunil Gavaskar. You know, he used to face, not discriminating those fast bowlers from India, they used to bowl 75 miles or 85 miles per hour. Next day, he used to face 95 miles, 100 miles per hour for the West Indian fast bowlers. So I used to read his books also. So how did he manage this? So each one ball at a time, every 15 minutes, take a mental break, and wait for the session breaks, wait for the drinks, wait for the lunch. So that I followed. So what happened, I was struggling in South Africa, and when we came back to Bangladesh before the test match, all the time thinking, how can I play for a longer time? How can I make a long, big score? So made the plan, really small plans, one ball at a time, and that will help a lot to continue the concentration for a longer time.
Excellent, thanks, Aminul. Yep.
You mentioned the softball game. I've lucky enough to see a few of those. They can be completely unproductive. Can you focus in on the softball game?
So the question was just around what Tilan said earlier about the unstructured play in Sri Lanka with the softballs, and the gentleman's just looking for a bit more description of it, and I guess how it assists.
Yes, softball means we play a lot of road cricket after school. Nothing. We have a good structured school cricket. I think one of the best in Asia because in our school cricket structure is really good. But our parents or coaches, a lot of coaches encourage us to play a lot of softball cricket, because if you play softball cricket, you will get that flair. Like I played more my cricket L-shape. Every time I play softball cricket in L-shape. If I have to score either straight or either have to score a square. And when I getting bigger and bigger, I used to score a lot of square because of my hands getting used to that. When I play 9 to 15, I play a lot of softball cricket in L shape. That's why I can't hit leg side, because if I hit leg side, that's out. We never get that ball again. I think that those things help some of players, definitely.
That answer your question? Yeah.
What drills are the best we have? So, we always say about finding the gaps and whatever. So, what drills did you do growing up to actually help to find those ones?
I thought you might hand that to me. I have no idea.
So, at Eastern Suburbs, Mike, obviously, Michael's a great coach in Sydney.
Yeah.
So, you're obviously going to have people that look to you when they can't score a run and go, tell me how you did it, kind of thing. So at grade level, how are you working with batsmen?
Well, how do you get batsmen to hit gaps? And it's pretty hard, but you've got to know where the gaps are first. So you've got to clearly identify and articulate when the ball is bowled here, where is it going to go? And, you might test them out and see, a couple of underarms or off the tee or whatever, and say, all right, we can hit that gap 5 out of 10 or whatever. Under these conditions or scenarios at this level of pressure, and then it's probably about, so I'm not actually a really big technical coach, it's not my scene, it's not my thing, I probably concentrate on other facets, but you know, if you're trying to build a skill and you're trying to hit your gaps, well, one, understand what ball is going to where, what spot. So clearly identify it first, and then just reduce the skill back to something that, you know, from a technical perspective, what do they have to do to hit that gap? And then from an implementation perspective, where do they need to start in terms of drills? You know, and so, which I think is a very important thing as a coach, is that you don't want to blow people out of the water. You know, you need to give them some confidence, some hope, and before moving on to a higher level intensity skill, they need to have got the lower one 10 out of 10. And so, does that make sense? In terms of drills that they could do 10 out of
progressions?
Yeah, so, you know, that's a little, that would be, if I did it, I don't, that would be the simple format or plan I would use to be sort of increasing that. But then again, I would come back to, is that what they need to learn at this point in time? So that would be the question I'd always challenge myself. What is it they need to learn at this point in time to take the next step? And if you decide that they need to hit more gaps, then that's you've got the right one, you know. And improvement is going to happen rapidly. If you pick the wrong issue and you practice it and it's not the right one, you'll never get improvement. You know what I mean?
So tell Anne. Oh, sorry, I'm not
used to add with Michael one thing that picking up the gap, develop that skill, particular skill or particular shot. But I think that if we teach that particular player, I'm going to teach this only the skills when we do the block training. If we can make him play very early, in between and late, so when he's master of playing three areas, then he'll be able to play. But if you play very late to the covers, definitely on the left hand side. If you play on time to the player, if you play early, definitely on the right hand side. So these are the things. If we experiment more, so. From as Fleming said, that progression from easy to complex to easy to complex. So if we do that time per time, 100 times, I'm sure that they'll be master on that shot.
Yeah, Aminul, that's a really good point. Tilan, there's been a couple of times, obviously, I've been lucky enough to work with you and your brother with the spin bowlers over at the nets, and you guys just stroll into the nets without pads on and are batting against the under 19 guys that are bowling some spinners, and it's because you're doing what Aminul says and playing the ball in front of you and taking the spin out of the equation and being able to hit the gaps, is that?
Yeah. I think that's the thing. I think as Aminul said, you have three contact positions, he said. And against spin, I think we have different grip to the Australian. We are going more all in the English type grip. I think that's why we use the more wrist and all, because of the we use a little bit different to the Australians. That's why, and wickets are a little slower, and that's why our wrist we use a lot for the spinners.
Another question?
I'll go, Neil. Just probably harping on a little bit. Obviously, Australian cricket and Cricket Australia with their coaching at the moment are talking very much from an implicit learning perspective rather than going through drills and that. And there's obviously a great book by Steve Canane called First Test that talks about how all the great Australian players develop their skills in backyards and out there. Obviously, Tilan touched on it with the L-shape venue, so you couldn't hit on the leg side, but you hit strong there and you were strong straight as well. What about all the guys? Obviously, played at the highest level. Was there anything from your upbringing, whether backyard cricket or playing at school, that helped develop you to play well, develop the skills that got you to the highest level that you probably picked up from playing backyard cricket or whatever happened in Bangladesh before? I'm not sure what happened there. But yeah, it'd be good to hear that, hear those stories about how you developed your skills, but probably in less structured environments.
Before Bangladesh, I just want to mention one thing. I coach Chinese, actually. I developed cricket in China. And they call it, they don't call Chinese cricket. They say Bancho. They have different translations in cricket. So Chris also went to China. So what they do to develop their skill, in the hotel or in the most of the players, they are from universities. They don't have any club culture, so they learn cricket in the educational institutions. So in the dormitory or in the hostel, they are very strong playing straight shots. They can't play square cut, they can't play sweep. So I was asking the head coach, what happened? Why can't they play sweeps and cuts? They said they most of the time, 3 or 4 hours they train straight shots only, because the corridor of the hostel is very narrow and straight. So that's the thing. And in Bangladesh, what we used to, most of the players you can find when you see them playing, they're very good on drivings, because the wickets in Bangladesh are very flat. Even school cricket to international cricket, everywhere, the wicket is very flat. So this is the culture they brought throughout the generations. But they're very weak against the short pitch ball. So this is the area they should work more on this. But they're master of playing anything in any other way.
So no, was there anything from you?
Flem, you've obviously got a couple of kids and involved as well around junior cricket.
They're getting used to the bouncer. I'm not being soft on my kicks, so plenty of bouncers. So they're very good on the short ball. But no, a bit the same, like the implicit learning. You know, we sort of had nets, so most of us used to try and hit it back over the bowler's head. I think we probably played. The thing that doesn't happen as much now is unstructured cricket. They definitely don't play as much at school. And I'd love them to come up with their own rules and come up with their own structures. I think bowling with even a tennis ball teaches you a lot, because if you keep bowling the same type of ball, there's no swing, there's no extra bounce. So, you know, I think that's where you start to develop, you know, a quicker bouncer, you know, yorkers, cutters, those type of things. So I think, you just hope that, you know, 100% of the kids learning at the moment isn't structured at under 12s, under 14 nets. You hope that they can play enough in the backyard, you know, have the shortcomings of only different areas you can hit. So when you're bowling, you're actually trying to force them to hit to, if it's out on the barbecue on the leg side, to angle in and see what they can manipulate there. So I see that as an important thing, you know, but there is Milo cricket and T20 Blast, those type of programs, which I think is great, but geez, I'd love to get kids playing more at lunchtime or getting early to school to have a go at those sort of things, because it's no doubt it's helped, you know, the generations of cricketers from all nations, you know, up until now.
While we're on that, just one other thing. I heard the greatest ever statistic on an Australian cricketer ever. It was in relation to Michael, and I want to confirm it. Apparently someone rang up that could have been champions, it was about 20 years ago, and said, you know, when you play at lunchtime, and if you're not out at the end of lunchtime, you bat again the next lunchtime, keep going.
Yeah, right.
Someone said you batted for a term and a half at your school. Is that correct?
I don't know. All you cricket fans out there have heard of Bevatax. But they're false as well. They're false as well.
You can't say that. We won't go through them here, but I just thought one was coming up there. Just make your questions nice and easy for Michael.
Yeah.
I'm not sure who to direct this question to, but at our club at North Elphington, we have 6 under-11s teams, so it's quite fashionable at the moment, cricket. And I want to know how much emphasis you put on batting technique versus just scoring runs. Because with so many kids, some of them are quite good batsmen, and others just love to play the hoik over the down corner all the time. So we try to tell them, yeah, play straight, but then you take all these scoring opportunities out. So how far do you go with technique?
First thing is, if I get an 11-year-old or 12-year-old kid, I teach him cut and pull, because most 11-year-old and 12-year-olds bowl short pitch bowling, and if you good with cut and pull, they will score runs. And if they will score runs, that means they will stay in the game. Otherwise, no point teaching straight away four defense and playing straight. After that, they score runs, and they're interested about the cricket, and then you can teach more straight drives, four defense, other sort of technical shots.
Cut shot is important.
I think cut and pull, because I think 11-year-old never bowl full. because they bowl short most of the time. If you have cut and pull really good and you will score runs, I think 25, they can score 25.
Oh, for our kids, they just bat for four overs. Oh, they just go six for four overs.
And if you, yeah, I mean, if you score...
Well,
yeah.
But at the same time, in this age, is basically the beginners, and if you spend too much time on them teaching skills, which is waste of time, they will not listen. And you can mark them that they will ask unnecessary questions, their performance will be very inconsistent, not consistent. And also in this area, coaches should interfere, should be not very much, little. But as long as they're enjoying this game, as long as they're hitting and they're taking catches, taking wickets, that's more. But I suppose if you find some talent in this age, please consider, because this is the age you can find out of 10, maybe 3, 4 talent figures.
Yeah, I reckon by the under 13s, 14s, you're starting to refine their technique a bit. Interesting, when I first went down there, like the shot to cow corner is the natural shot, isn't it, for all of us? And we've gone through years of generations where we've got rid of that, coached that out, and let's just play the V. Yet we're going through a current era of cricketers all trying to learn, relearn the slog sweep and all that. So I'm sort of not... coaching out the slog sweep, but just trying to tell them the right time to do that. Definitely the forward and back defence and the cut shot. You know, you're trying to nail that at under 12 level. By under 14 level, they're getting strong enough. This is the kids who don't dominate because they're big sloggers. No, these are littler kids. And definitely they're starting to get the rewards. The guys that can block the good balls, they can cut, and they've still got that sort of pull shot you're talking about because we haven't coached that out of them. And with the bowlers, a little bit like we talked about before, you know, just making sure that they're running towards the target. Trying to explain that, you know, really, until you take off, as the old Johnny Harmer used to say, you're actually just an athlete. You're a 400 metre runner with a cricket ball in your hand. Then you take off, then you turn into a bowler. So trying to explain to them that just run like you normally run. Just because you've got a cricket ball, we all change, don't we? So try and just be a runner until that takeoff step, and then we get into being a bowler.
Yep. Yes. You were talking about finding Nat who's batting, and Maxwell is somewhere looking for it. Can you explain a little bit more about this? I mean, is that something the rituals we follow before standing in the grave or something else?
Yeah, I'm not sure, but I think the general thing, we're talking about how Simo got the map to his career, and I had my little, I called it the recipe of success, things that I had to control from my end to be at my best. Now, the thing is, as a bowler, we're the proactive ones, aren't we? We're actually the one that set the ball into play. These dumb batsmen can only react to it, can't they? So hopefully you're trying to bowl down a really good delivery. I was another one, a bit like Bevo, you know, got to about 27, had a lot of injuries, was struggling a bit, and I halved my runner, you know, from about 28 steps to, well, it was 12 in the end, which looked too short. But for me, I just felt like it was a Shield game up in Queensland, very hot, we're getting flogged as usual, Victorian team up in Queensland. We had a young attack, and I thought, I'm going to have to bowl about 35 overs here today. So I just went to the half run-up, the same run-up when we used to play league cricket against each other over in England. And the thing is, for me, it just felt I could bowl quicker for longer. I was stable on my takeoff step, and I felt like I had a higher release. So for me, that really worked well. And my recipe, as I said, my mantra was I had to take two deep breaths when I had that short run, because if I overstrode early, I was in real trouble because I only had 12 steps. Off stump, rhythm, power was my mantra. Off stump was the line I wanted to run in, but also it was the line I wanted to bowl. Just about every bowler that's ever bowled very well for Australia or local cricket says, well, what happened today? I had good rhythm. But you can't see rhythm, can you? You know, you actually need to just define what rhythm is. And rhythm for me was short to long, as we talked about there. I had to make sure. I knew if I was too short at the start, you can always make up long, but you can't go long, short, long. That's not rhythm. And power was another big for me, particularly off this short one. So power was defined as pushing off with my back leg as hard as I could in combination with that. It's already pointed off stump, so it's almost like I'm pulling off stump to myself. So that would get a powerful follow through, stare at the batsman, and then plan the next one. So I can do that whether I've got none for 100 or 5 for 20, isn't it? That's controllable. So that gave me confidence knowing that I can control that mind map or the recipe for success that I talked about there. Also, within the first over, I want to get my stop ball going straight away, okay? I don't want to be worried about I'm too short, too full. Get my stop ball going, so my confidence up, and then I'll start reading the pitch. Okay, is it a quick pitch? Or is it a green pitch? Well, it's green light. I'm going to bowl full. I want them attacking and coming at me hard. I'm not bowling outside of stump waiting for them to come to me. I'm bowling middle and leg and I'm swinging across there. If it's a dry pitch, red, conditions, I normally got injured, got myself off the pitch, which helped me out a lot. But obviously I was going to bring my length back a lot more. I'm going to bowl quicker, hit the splice hard, and then I'm going to bowl them quicker bounces or push them back and bowl a quicker Yorker and use my slow ball a lot. Just to mix, I want to mix up their rhythm a little bit there. And reading what the batsmen are doing. So even someone like Tendulkar, who used to get hundreds against us for fun, he's coming off 200s, but guess what? I bowl a couple, he's caught on the crease a little bit. You know, he's at a different form at this stage. Okay, I've got to be there to read that. So if he's caught on the crease, okay, I'm going to push him back for two balls and then bowl that fuller outswinger. He might go at that. So a lot of it was about, I think, with the map or whatever I do there, or your cues or your keys, are controllable things you can do regardless what the match conditions are doing, what the batsmen are doing. And I reckon you build confidence from that.
And replicate them in practice all the time as well.
And I used to nail them at practice. Just nail them at practice. I just felt like you just rock up the ball, you knew what you were doing, and you had confidence. And when things were going badly, at least you could always fall back on something. I used to hate when I felt like, I was a goal setter. If I felt like, I wasn't going to achieve that goal, I really struggled. So my main goals for each game, didn't matter who I was playing for, was to be the best bowler in the game and to sing the song. So obviously if I was the best bowler in the game, there's a good chance we're going to sing the song.
Awesome. Yes.
We'll
go
ahead. Just two things. Firstly, with under 12s, I've been teaching them to use the aeroplane method. They taxi into their head up and they hit the piece and the stumps at full pace. But the other thing, the four of you haven't spoken about tonight, and it's one thing every cricketer does 100% of the time, fielding. Could you give us a drill each on one of your points? Pre-match drill.
Bevo was quick to the ball, he couldn't catch, so you're no good. I was slow to the ball, but could catch. What about you guys? Fielding wise. Michael?
Thanks, mate.
It doesn't even have to be a drill, guys, but maybe just what you see the key components of fielding.
I reckon fielding is for a team with a good environment, that's where you can measure how well this team's going. If you set up a basic training drill, even if you've got the two stumps and you're going around and getting them throwing all that, to hear the energy and the voice, I reckon you can have so much fun with fielding. And as I said, it's a good indication where you're going. I suppose for me, I remember when we made the Australian team about the same time, and Bob Simpson was our coach at the time, and he was the first guy that ever gave me a couple of fielding lessons, because I actually used to have a really strong arm before I had a Rico, but I used to wind up the same way in the outfield in the inner ring, so I'm wasting time. So Bob was the first one to go, hey mate, you can't wind up like that in the inner ring. You've got to be like Alan Border, get it there that way. I can't remember what he said to you, Bevo, but we had us for a session wherever we were. So it's those sort of things, having fun with it, but also make yourself a really good fielder and challenge yourself against the best fielders, having catching sessions against the best slips fieldsmen, even for the faster bowlers, getting them a bit of an experience there. But I think fielding training should be a little bit like playing footy and footy codes. You should be able to have a lot of voice, create a lot of energy and have a lot of fun as well.
Yeah, he didn't say anything to me, actually. I don't know if that meant anything.
He had to around 2 hours.
I don't even know if I'm qualified to answer the questions for under 11s and 12s. I mean, I've never coached under 11s or 12s, but one thing I would think that would need to happen is that, there would need to be a lot of game playing and incorporating sort of drills within games so it's fun. Because let's face it, fielding ain't that fun. I mean, and it's highly important, but there's always something else to work on that's more important. You know, your batting, your bowling. So time is, you know, actually doing it is the first thing. Second is how you do it. And, you know, I would be thinking, you know, a lot of different types of games that incorporate basic drills, but I don't know what they are.
That's a pretty good answer.
Actually, so I just had one there before I chuck it to you. Just nailing the basics. I'm often disappointed dealing with the under 12s and 14 girls and boys. You know, their basic throwing and catching isn't done. I wish that was nailed at school, because then you can have a lot more fun with drills. So I'd encourage you. I know the hard thing is being a club coach, you might be the only guy down there, so you're running and timing the nets. So it's really hard to do that specialist coaching, but you can get another spare dad down there to help out so you can specialise in them, because then you can do those high quality drills. And we played, the Sun played against, was it Blackburn, I think, and an ex-district player called Scotty Hubber was taking him, and he was doing like a district fielding run, and I thought, geez, that's really good to see and all this, and I'm thinking, we couldn't do that because half our team wouldn't be able to stop the ball, which would stop the drill, and then you can't get into the throwing and catching. So I reckon as much as we can, we're just going to nail that basics as young as they are, and now they are, because then you can have a lot more fun, hopefully, when you get to the 13s and 15s. I mean, you guys got something to say on the
field? I was just going to change the question a little bit for Aminul and Tilan. So Aminul, obviously with the minnows, I know I hate that word because it gets used to describe Scotland all the time, but the smaller nations, the non-test playing nations, I guess, fielding's the great equaliser. Everyone can field just as well, whether you're Australia or the United Arab Emirates. When Bangladesh came into the test match circuit and the first class circuit, I guess, was that a focus for you guys? Was being the equal of the teams you were playing against with the fielding?
Actually, fielding is two important components involved. One is the age, another one is the fitness. So Bangladesh were always a young team. They always were a very, very good fielding side, but not technically like what Australians or South Africans are, or sometimes Sri Lankans. These Australia, South Africa, and Sri Lanka, they're technically much more stronger than Bangladesh and Zimbabwe those days. But as I said, that the fitness is very, very important for fielding side and age group. The team is having average age is over 37. You can see the fielding side is a bit weak, but the team is below 24 or 26, they're always a better fielding side. So, and fielding also to improve, I believe that is very very much individual. So, and it's not like pitching, batting and bowling, it's you can improve in a week. If you track, if you profile it properly, within 3-4 weeks, you can see that one of your fielders, better fielders, by doing lots of practice. So, as Bangladesh, I should say that still they're young, they're always a good fielding team, but technically still a bit lack than some of the countries.
Tilan, my question was, I guess, something that Aminul mentioned there. So Sri Lanka obviously had some excellent fielders, some jet fielders, but then they had some people that perhaps weren't as mobile in the field, but contributed in other ways. How did the team incorporate those not so good fielders and still be a successful fielding unit?
I think, especially from a younger age, 13, 15, 17, in Australia, a lot of parents coaching. In Sri Lanka, more qualified coaches coaching. That's the, and they give more technical stuff to the younger generation. And when you come to the Sri Lanka team, we do more specific fielding. More slippers go to, they do a lot of slip catching, point, cover, they do a lot of things. And whoever stay in the mid-wicket, short mid-wicket, he do those drills. And whoever standing in the boundaries and or last in rowers, and they do their drills. That's why they are so good fielding team in last 10 years.
Because you have specific roles.
We do specific roles.
Yep, sorry.
Yeah, I just had a question for Michael about the batting plans. We're right at the start about addressing 10 overs, and I guess trying to understand when I was playing cricket a long time ago at school, the whole message, rightly or wrongly, was ball on its merits, every ball react to what's there. Seems quite different to how you approached it, with, I think you said, each over perhaps a four and a one. I'm just wondering, when coaching people that way with a plan, how do you stop them losing confidence if they get six good balls in a row they have to block and they feel the plan has gone out the window? How do you balance the two?
We all start off with good intentions in terms of how we're trying to play, and then, you know, bowls well, and that's where we're challenged in the match. And I can remember numerous times where I didn't get balls where I wanted to, and you then have to make a decision: do I play a shot that I can't play, or do I just acknowledge that it's really good bowling and it's not my day, or then go back to the drawing board and say, right, when they bowl here, I've got to have a shot to counter that, which again is a long process to build skills into your game. So I always try and keep it basic, reduce everything back to the basics, the most general, important stuff that people need to learn. And so for me, the simplest game plan that I encourage players to play or get them to focus on is really only two things. One, play to your strengths, because you can't go out in the game and play a shot that you can't play. So one, you need to play your strengths and you have to commit to it, I suppose. And then the other thing is you need to play those strengths to the correct ball. So that's a decision making. So that trumps all other plans. You can't get better than that. Play to your strengths, choose the right ball to kick. So whenever you're in doubt, go back to those core fundamentals that you can focus on. And that holds true in, you know, I'm coaching a club, you know, a great club that have got 50 players, five teams, like, you know, some of us here, you know, five teams in three different formats, and I can't teach them different ways to play in different games. I don't have the time, I don't have the resources. So again, I'm making the decision, what do I have to say, what has to happen at this point in time to get maximum bang for your buck. And so for me, this is the core philosophy I want to get across. Play to your strengths, choose the right ball to hit.
Awesome. Thanks, mate.
I think question for you. Oh, sorry. Yes, Adrian.
I'm just interested in getting some opinions on spin bowling and the future of it. You spoke tonight about even the one day or the World Cup with two new balls, fielding restrictions, the variations that medium paces are able to come up with. What would your take be on spin bowling? Is it a dying art, or how would you reinvigorate it?
Geez, they're thriving in T20 though.
Yeah,
they?
Exactly.
But that's five out. I know it's only a 20 over game. And it'll be interesting to see the aftermath of all the Dutra bowlers, isn't it? What happens if we can get a generation of spinners that are able to make the ball go both ways? Because, you know, doing T20 cricket and one-day cricket in the media last few years, like once it got down the middle to late order, as soon as Narine or Ajmal got in and they couldn't pick him, no one could really pick him, it was game over. So they were game changers, but they're going to probably have to come up with, you know, different ways of surviving and thriving there well, as if the Dutra is impossible to keep under the throwing ratio. So, it's an interesting one. As I said, in the Big Bash in the IPL, the spinners have been amazing. I mean, you look at Vittori and Beer, left arm orthodoxes, they don't turn the ball a lot, but their overspin, their angles. I think they're going to get clever, you know, with the field placements. We saw at times they'd have four out on the leg side. And just dart the ball in, knowing that, you know, the wood bowl made an over, but they weren't probably going to leak a boundary there as well. So there's still different ways to provide varieties. So I'd imagine the spinners will still thrive a bit, but for this World Cup, the two new balls only four out. They don't have a lot of overs to bowl in, I don't reckon.
It's very important, like,
people have already seen those three good players who used to bowl losers. One is Shaklan Mustaq, then Asmal and Kohli. So what I think that as coaches or other future plan, we have to bring some more leg spinners, right-hand leg spinners or left-arm Chinaman. The reason we get a lot of off spinner is very easy to bowl. This finger we use every time, eating, writing, shutting up somebody, using so much of this finger. So the last touch of off spin is basically this finger. But this is the leg spin feeling finger, and we only use this when we get engaged with a girl. So this is the finger we never use much. So if we, at the age of 11, as you said, 11, 12, 13, if you started using this finger a lot, let's bowl leg spin. That's the only ball that takes lots of wickets. And it's very hard to predict because it's a very open skill. It can be a googly, it can be a leg spin, it can be a flipper, it can be anything. So the leg spinners era is coming, and we as coaches, we're playing more leg spinners to survive or win more matches. That's what I think.
I think I have a different opinion. I think this is a good thing to see how much dying leg spin because of this five fielders in the ring. No team, especially good teams, never pick leg spinners in this World Cup, only Imran Hayat. That's why I think South Africa have a big problem. They have to find 20 overs. I know everyone saying South Africa is a slight favorite in this World Cup. They have to find 20 overs because they will rely on Farhad Bharat. Bharati or something like that. He's batting number 7 and bowl little medium pace. Yes. Germany should bowl off spinners part-time. I think that's why I think this is a good World Cup to see how much dying leg spin. Because every team picks finger spinners because they pick finger spinners because they have more control and they can hit one side of the ground. That's why most good teams pick finger spinners. Because they have more control and they can bowl one side of the pitch, and the batsmen try to hit one side because 5 feet is inside, very hard to spin bowl.
So the question is around Nathan Lyon's omission from the one-day squad and Doherty getting picked and then probably not going to play in favour of Maxi.
Maybe they didn't want to have two off-spinners with Max online, but maybe the philosophy is pick your best spinner. And Lyon, you've got to remember, he debuted in state cricket in the Big Bash. T20 is bowling in the first six overs. So he emerged as a T20 spinner. Didn't play a lot of one-day cricket, straight in the test team, and then hardly played a one-day or T20 since. But even in the Big Bash, once there was a little bit of turn in the pitch, the batsman found him hard to play. So I wouldn't be surprised in hindsight, they'd already picked the team that they might have felt like they'd got it wrong there. Doherty's a very good defensive bowler. I think he's someone at the end of his career could say, did you get the best out of himself? Yes, he did. You know, he can bowl Yorkers. He can dart it in. When they're going after him, he's got good defensive mechanisms. But spinning the ball's not great. I could have seen playing except for the SCG. But if Maxi gets hit, I mean, he's the other option. Would it be handy to have Lyon in there, who's so experienced now? A lot of left-handers in opposition batting lineups. I personally reckon they've got it wrong by Lyon not being part of that. Michael?
Yeah, well, look, I mean, it depends on the wickets that you're playing on. It depends on how many left-hand batters they've got in the opposition team. Depends on his fielding abilities, you know, his batting ability. There's probably no reason why he couldn't be a success and do a job. And, you know, I've not seen domestic competition. I don't know his stats in the Big Bash. I don't know his stats in one-day cricket, which is, you know, or whether he's getting the opportunity to bowl in one-day games in domestic cricket to have the opportunity to impress the claims to play for the Australian one-day team. So maybe
he's doing everything he can. Maybe he's actually bowling well. Maybe he's taking wickets. Maybe he just doesn't play enough matches and the selectors aren't looking at him. I'm not too sure. I'm not really... There's no reason why he couldn't play or he shouldn't play. But for whatever reason, the selectors have decided to run with a different team. And part of that is because of the wickets that we're playing on over in Australia. We talked about spin bowling before and variation, etc., etc. And, you know, we just don't get the opportunity. Spinners, unless you're a really, really good spinner, play smaller roles in hard wicket conditions, whereas you know, slow wicket conditions, subcontinent countries, it's more prevalent. And it could be as simple as that.
I've got another question here, just because no one's starting to have one. Michael, this one's for you as well, my friend. As someone that's gone into coaching from playing, in terms of a mentor or someone that you talk to around coaching, do you have one of them? Is that something that you use regularly or not something that you have?
No, I don't have a mentor. I mean, I've never got to the stage or even though I've done a little bit of professional coaching, have I ever got to the point of saying, look, I think I need a mentor or a mentor, and I probably do need one or could have one. But then again, I've been fortunate to play for some really successful teams. You know, I played for the Australian team, one of the most successful international teams of all time. I played for New South Wales, best state in Australia. How much success? For my first four Shield seasons, we made two Shield finals. The four Shield finals lost two, won two. And yeah, we probably lost to the Vicks at one stage. And then I had all these legends surrounding me. So I guess what I'm saying is that, in a sense, I had a lot of very, very good mentors. And because I'm analytical, I like understanding why teams are doing well and what they're doing to enable that to happen. So I was always a passive learner in the sense that I'm a bit of a watcher. And, you know, I'd like to understand what they're doing, but probably why they're doing it as well. I've had a lot of great mentors and different types of coaches. So, you know, someone like a Steve Rickson, who was really kind of assertive and directive coach, whereas someone like Buchanan's a bit analytical, a bit more collaborative maybe. I've got to see all the different coaching styles that people have and what works and what doesn't work. And I'm a big believer that, for me, I'm a really results-orientated person. And so I don't really care what style you use, how you learn, but I like to see what result you're getting from that method, I suppose. So, I've had a lot of good mentors, and I think sometimes with coaching too, you know, you kind of expect it to know everything or be everything, and quite clearly you can't. And so it's always nice to, plenty of times I don't know anything when I'm talking to someone, and when I don't know someone, I never say anything, I just ask a question. Because then I sort of find out about where they're at, I suppose. So, I've had a lot of good mentors, but just from a playing perspective, I suppose.
Damon, got a question?
Yeah. Christian for bowling under nine, so really some of them can get the seam bowled upright, which is amazingly, on 39 they can't, but some of them they just can't do it. How do you get the young guys to...
Well, that's a tough one, I reckon. I think it's more a positive that there's a few that are getting the scene right. I think it's too young to judge. Under nines, I'd be just encouraging the participation and enjoying it.
Don't even worry about it.
As long as you'd like them to get their fingers straight down the seam. And if they're doing that, and as I said, trying to run to the target, you'd hope in the years to come that they'll get a bit better. But so, yeah, definitely get the grip right to start. But I wouldn't be worrying too much if they're undercutting the ball or the bowling leg cutters and all that there. I just think it's about fun, let them have a really good experience. I find, up until probably under 14s, the nets are good. because, you know, they start off and they're hitting the side net there and there, and they've got half a brain that's going, oh, well, I need to do this to get the ball down the other end. So it's actually a training guy drilling the nets, isn't it? But even I'm finding, by about the under-14s, you want to do more game sense and play more practice matches against, if you've got another team who's in the nets next to you, get out there, because under-14s still an issue, running between the wickets, calling, walking in to the bowler, you know, knowing how to value your wicket, you know, in the first six balls there, minimising the wides and extras. So that's the progression that I've seen from we had under-10s. Hey, let's just have fun. Give them a great experience. Make sure they're coming back to play in the under-12s. The 12s, you're starting to make sure there's more and less extras. You're starting to build a bit of a defence and a cut shot and all that sort of stuff. You're trying to nail that running between the wickets and calling. But I reckon by the first year 14s, what I've noticed, and even the second year, if they're A grade, get them out to game sense as much as you can. Use the centre wicket. Because, as I said, I don't think they're playing that unstructured cricket and making their own games as much. So their cricket education isn't getting as complete, I reckon, as most of us when we were playing young. We played, you know, hundreds of games of cricket with the next door neighbours in the backyard of the schoolyard. So by getting centre wicket if you can, I reckon it's just gold.
Okay, we'll go
with
two more questions. Last question. So this is for everyone, and we'll go to Bevan last because I know he's a thinker and he'll like to think about this one. So, who's your pick for? Because it's a World Cup coaching seminar, we've got to finish with a World Cup question to land. So, who's going to win the World Cup?
I think this is a slightly different World Cup. I think a lot of teams feel it. I can say first four, honestly. I can't
but
say
who's
going
to
win.
Go for one, Tilan.
Yep.
Go to pick one.
One. I think I go Australia, because they covered their 15 men, scored all basics, and their skills, everything they covered. They have informed two openers. I think that is crucial for this World Cup, to inform openers. And they are middle-order very solid. And they are number 7, 8, 9, good. Good finishes there, and with the new ball they have up front, they have they can take wickets. I'd love to see two players in the team definitely in this World Cup. One is captain Michael Clarke, because when you go to knockout stages, I think you need that tactical awareness definitely. Because I think I played with him, for me, he's the best captain opposition for me. And other thing is Hazel Wood, he's more steady with up front. And he will take more wickets. I know Mitchell Johnson and Stark, they can hit it every day. They can bowl quick. But Hazelwood and Michael Clarke is there. I'd love to see Australia. I think Australia is a top favorites this World Cup.
All right. You'll make it out here in one piece?
I'm not a fortune teller, but looking at the performances, looking at the form, looking at the home advantage, I'm with Tilan, actually. There are two teams very close, which is South Africa and Australia. New Zealand, obviously, in New Zealand. But I think Australia has more chance because they're playing at home. And also, a lot of people say at home winning is very tough. And they don't win. But in 1992, they already knew that at home, how did they lose? How they couldn't win. So they know how did they couldn't do that. So, and some of the players are in tremendous form. And if you see their batting lineup, there are batters, everybody is all in form, and everybody wants to play. So there are extra two batters always in the team. In 1996, when Sri Lanka won, they had one extra batsman always, number 6, that was Manama. And only one match he played is for 60, that was needed. So Australia had two, Faulkner, and if Clarke is fit, and Australia has a very, very strong chance. And bowling-wise, the fast bowlers are very, very steady. They're playing at home. They know their mechanics and everything. So Australia has a very, very strong chance in this tournament, I think.
Yeah, New Zealand going to be really tough. They're building a really good team there. Plenty of explosion batting up the top. Bolt and Saudi very skilled in those conditions. The only question is, can they live up to the hype at home? I think the Australian game over there is going to be a real indicator where they're going. I expect them to make the semi-final. South Africa, A.B. De Beers, Amla, Du Plessis, you've got Steyn and Morkel and that with the ball. They'll make the semi-final stage and choke again, so they won't make the final. So my winner...
Just on that, Flynn, just because we haven't even talked about it. Just those 5 seconds.
No, I can't. No. Not for 5 seconds.
That
overtakes about 90 minutes now, and poor Harrow's heard it 1,000 times. Sri Lanka, you've got to admire them. Every T20, 50 over, they're there at semi-final stage, mainly because they can bat really deep. Now, how well has Matthews gone since he's been captain? Malinga, he might not start on fire, but he'll just get fitter and fitter throughout the tournament up the top. But not surprisingly, I've got Australia winning. I just think there's a lot of depth at here. To think in their best team, George Bailey won't play, and probably Patrick Cummins won't play. I reckon those two guys would get games in most of the other teams. So expecting the Aussies to win it there in front of 100,000 people. Michael.
Damien. I don't know. I feel with New Zealand is that they generally play really well with the underdog tag. And this is one of the few occasions that they're actually favourites. And so they tend to play better with the underdog. So it's maybe not so much a home ground advantage, but it's actually now that they've got something to lose or they're considered a chance might go against them. I think a lot depends on the wickets, because if the wickets, because it's an extra long season or they're playing more, if they're worn or they're a bit lower or slower, or bring the subcontinent teams back into contention and conversely make it tougher for the harder wicket players, teams. Australia's very, very talented. There's only a couple of things that I would, say maybe be against them, and that is the big match experience, in terms of the guys playing World Cup. I think South Africa have probably got the most well-balanced team, and you would, in terms of experience, in terms of quality players. So I would expect South Africa would challenge very strongly to win it. So, probably South Africa would be my tip, yeah.
Excellent. All right, guys, well, thank you for your time this evening. Thanks to the panel for all their support and giving up their time.
Just one thing, can I get Flynn to award the best question tonight? Australia have just texted through, they've got 2 tickets to South Africa, India, which will award to whoever Flynn I thought asked the best question.
Jeez.
So have a bit of thinking time.
Hang on, I've got to feel a few more questions.
We might not, we won't put Flynn, so Flynn can do it once we finish.
Yeah,
Paul
yeah.
And I will find the person and give them the tickets, and we'll put them on the spot like that. thank you, like I said, for giving up your evening to come. Hopefully, I mean, personally standing up here and listening to all the different takes from all the different coaching philosophies and styles and experiences was amazing for me. And I think everybody should have got something out of it, whatever level you're coaching, whether it's grade cricket down to the under-11s. You're welcome to grab some food on your way out and any bottles of water you have, and if we could just finish by giving the panel a round.